We went through the month of Ramadan. We celebrated the Eid. Now we are already into the second week of the month of Shawwal. And it's appropriate to ask this question, so what after Ramadan? Is it only once a year event, or is there something after Ramadan where we can still seek the blessing of that process? And this is where we had to go back to the purpose of fasting in Ramadan. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the very first ayat in that passage in Surah Baqarah, which were revealed about the fasting, he ends by the words, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, that he made fasting obligatory on you so that hopefully you will maintain your taqwa, the sense of, you know, righteousness, and always maintain this consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even at the end of that passage, it's a long passage, there are a few ayat there, where he says, referring to the mu'mineen, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. You know, this is repeated in the first ayat and the last ayat about Siyam, that hopefully they will, you know, acquire and maintain taqwa. And this is where we have to realize that it's not only for the month of Ramadan, it is our need for all the times. You know, in the discussions that we had during the month of Ramadan on this theme of taqwa, I mentioned that the only wasiyya or the advice which is wajib in the Friday khutbah is usikum ibadullah bi taqwallah. Nothing which says usikum ibadullah bi salat or bil hajj or bil zakat or different things. And so this is a very essential issue, and this is where we have to learn, you know, how do we maintain the spirit of taqwa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this opportunity to strengthen it, to increase it during the fasting of the month of Ramadan. Let me begin with a passage from a long khutbah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Muttaqeen. Remember, he is the leader of those who are muttaqeen, who have taqwa. In one khutbah number 191, he says, "Usikum ibadullah bi taqwallah," and then he says, "Fa'innaha haqqullah alaykum." Remember, taqwa is Allah's right upon you. He expects from you to fulfill his right by maintaining taqwa. Then the other side, وَالْمُوجِبَةُ عَلَى اللَّهِ حَقَّكُمْ. And taqwa also on the other side creates your right on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's Allah's haqq on us. And when you do that, you basically now have a right in the blessings of and the ajr and sawab and reward of the akhirah on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When tasta'inu alayha billah, you can actually help yourself against the displeasure and adab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa tasta'inu biha ala Allah, and you can gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the taqwa. Fa inna at-taqwa fil yawm al-hirz wal-junnah. Today, taqwa for you is the protection shield. It is a shield, a jannah. وَفِي غَدٍ الطَّرِيقِ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. And tomorrow it will be your path towards jannah. The word jannah is the shield, and jannah is the paradise, and jinnah is plural of jinn. This is where, you know, when you talk about Amir al-Mu'mineen, he is Imam al-Insi wal Jinnah. And then Ali says, مَسْلَكُهَا وَاضِحٌ وَسَالِكُهَا رَابِحٌ. The path of taqwa is very obvious and clear. If we have taqwa, we will be able to, you know, go through that path very easily. And the person who walks on this path, rabihun, is always going to be in profit and it will be beneficial for him. But at the end, these two words in this khutbah, it says, ala fasunuha wa tusawwanu biha. It says, beware, you have to protect it. Taqwa is there with you when you build it, increase it in the month of Ramadan. Then Ali says, don't think it is a solid item. It can decrease and it can increase. So now he says, therefore, once you acquire the taqwa, protect it. And when you protect it, it will in return protect you. And this is where, you know, it's a very important phenomenon that Ali is talking about on a spiritual development, that we have to protect our taqwa, which means taqwa is an entity which can decrease as well as it can increase. Month of Ramadan was the month of, you know, blessings and fasting. We worked on it. And inshallah, our taqwa increased. But at the end of the month, what do? Okay, alhamdulillah, we did the celebration in Eid and Khuda Hafiz. No, the issue is, Ali says, you protect it. Only when you protect it and maintain it, you know, and build more onto it, it will then in return protect you. It shouldn't be that whatever we acquired, by the end of next Sha'ban, it has gone to zero again. And this is the message that we get from Amir al-Mu'mineen. So how do we do this? How do we, you know, give nutrition to our power of taqwa? Fasting is a very powerful way of doing that. And so yes, Ramadan we fasted, but then this is where we come to this issue. So when I ask this question, so what after Ramadan? Ramadan is gone. But there is this process of recommended fasting during the entire Islamic calendar. And this is the whole purpose behind this, to maintain that spirit of taqwa that we have built during the month of Ramadan. You know, there are certain recommended days for every month after the month of Ramadan. For example, and this is easy to remember, first Thursday of the Islamic month and the last Thursday of the Islamic month. And in between, the first Wednesday after the 10th of the month. So we have 3 days there. First Thursday, last Thursday, and after the 10th of that month, the first Wednesday after that. And then, of course, 13th, 14th, and 15th of every month is also recommended for fasting. But this is where, you know, this is besides the special occasions that we have in, special occasions and days in the Islamic calendar. For example, in Shawwal, from 4th Shawwal to 9th Shawwal, which is already passed anyway. So let us remember it for next year, maybe. You know, but 1st, 2nd, 3rd, no. 1st is haram to fast, the day of Eid. Second and third day also is not recommended to fast. The recommendation starts from 4th to 9th. Because when we talk about Eid and celebration of Eid, you know, there is a sense in Islam that these celebrations can go on for 3 days. You know, and this is where we see 4th to 9th, the month of Zilqa'da, on 25th and 29th, in Zilhijjah, right from the beginning till a day before Eid. 1st to 9th, the day of Arafah. And then the day of Ghadir. And the day of Mubahala. In Muharram also, the 1st and 3rd and 7th of the month is recommended. In Rabiul Awwal, Miladun Nabi. You know, I know you will say, oh, Ghadir is a day of celebration. You want us to fast on that day. Well, you can have your feast at the end of the day. There's no problem there. You know, you don't necessarily have to have a lunch. You want to have a biryani, you can have it at the end of the day. You know, it doesn't have to be in the lunch menu on that day. And even in Rajab, you know, 27th of Rajab, the day of Bi'sat al-Mi'raj. So these are the recommended days. But I would urge myself, advise myself and you to work on the 3 days. First Thursday of the month and the last Thursday. And the first Wednesday after the 10th of the month. And if we are able to do that, from here to Sha'ban, you know, we would actually be doing a whole month of fasting. Not continuously, but you know, 3 days every month. And this becomes a good opportunity, you know, when it comes to the issue of fulfilling the qaza fasting. Because remember, in fasting, the ruling is that if you have qaza fasting, then you cannot fast with the niyat of sunnat. So you can have double reward there. You can maximize that first Thursday, last Thursday, first Wednesday after the 10th, you know, even do with the niyat of qaza. And if you do that, in 1 year you have completed actually more than 1 month of the qaza. And this is where we see that, you know, this will be one way of maintaining the spirit of taqwa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, blesses us with during the month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our understanding of this phenomenon of taqwa, and so that we can really live among those who are known as the muttaqeen and be the true followers of Imam al-Muttaqeen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. Just to continue on the same theme, what is after Ramadan? You know, besides this maintaining the spirit of taqwa on a spiritual level, another dimension of Ramadan, which was a very important element of that month, was the issue of charity, being concerned for the less fortunate members of the society. And this is something which has to be continued and sustained throughout the year according to our own means. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran talks about this issue, that when you give in charity, you know, maintain moderation. Do not be niggardly and bakhil, that you only think about yourself, oh, if I give in charity, what will happen to me tomorrow or next week or next month or next year? What will happen to my family after me? Nor be totally, you know, unorganized person who just doesn't think about future. So you have to maintain that balance within, even in the process of charity. But this is something which we have to continue. It's not only for the month of Ramadan. The wujub of fitrah on the day of Eid is just like, you know, the father is helping the child how to walk on his own. Initially, you know, the child will hold the fingers of the father and walk with him. And then the father, after a while, will let it go so that the child can learn how to walk by himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made fitrah wajib on us on the day of Eid. It was like he's handing, we are holding his hand in a symbolic sense. But then after that, he's letting us go, expecting that we will continue that path on our own. As far as sadaqat and khairat and donations are concerned, they are, in one way, we see the Muslim world, especially the Shia communities in the Middle East and other parts of the world, they are going through different kinds of challenges. And there are many good causes on which people, for which people can give their donations. And we have all different organizations who work for that. Sometimes it might sound competing, but alhamdulillah, all are, involved in worthwhile causes. And that is something we should appreciate. You look at the issue of widows and orphans. There are organizations working in Iraq. There are organizations working in Afghanistan, organizations working in Pakistan, in India. You have organizations which work for educational and relief of poverty in India and Africa and different parts of the world. And so, you have all these different kinds of appeals. And of course, it is our duty to look at the causes and have due diligence there. And once we are satisfied, it is your right, to choose where you want to give your donation. But I would like to talk about one important issue. And I hope people don't take it negatively, but this is something which has to be mentioned. I see these days, in the last, years or so, what I consider to be Khums Dependency Syndrome. And what I mean by that is that whenever we talk about charity cause, immediately the first question is, Maulana, can I give my khums for this? And sometimes even in individual cases, I have a circle of, people I know I would like to donate. In general, it shouldn't be a problem, but the issue is that you have to keep in mind that, when we talk about khums, especially when we talk about Sahm al-Imam, alayhi salatu wasalam, the portion of khums which belongs to the Imam of the time, during the time of ghaybat, it can only be used with the permission of the marja or the mushtahid that you follow. And so that is one thing that we have to keep in mind. Number two, remember, khums is a tax. It's not really a donation in that sense. And once, when I take out Sahm Imam, for example, for a project, it is actually now Sahm al-Imam. What does Sahm al-Imam mean? It is the share of the Imam. It belongs to him. I cannot give that Sahm al-Imam for a good cause and say, this is for the isal al-sawab of my father. In Urdu, we have a muscle, halwai ki dukaan mein. You can't go to the, the store where they sell sweets and say, okay, everybody recite Fatiha on my grandfather. Oh, well, the sweet doesn't belong to you. Sahm Imam belongs to the Imam of the time. So I cannot say that I am giving this for the isal al-sawab of my marhum father. If I want to do that, I have to look at, because what is khums? Khums is 20% of my savings at the end of the year. I should look at the 80%. Where is that 80% going? I'm not saying give the whole thing, huh? You're talking about use that 80%, maybe 20% after that, besides the khums, that is your money. There you can give. This is your true donation. This is voluntary donation. It's not a tax. There you can say, I am dedicating this for the sawab of my father, my mother, my grandparents, or whatever. And so just keep that in mind that, you know, let us not go into this issue of khums dependency for everything. There are purpose for it, there are usage for it, you know, but always think that if I have taken out 20%, it means I still have 80% of my savings. And use a portion of that, which is my money. And that is where you get this multiplied reward. 1 to 10, and if you did that in Ramadan, it was 1 to 70. You know, and that is something that we have to keep in mind, and that is the actually concept of fi sabilillah. Because when we talk about khums, that is basically more or less like tax rather than donation and charity in that way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our tawfiqat, you know, to fulfill our duties regarding others in the right way, inshallah. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وإمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما حيا صال البدء والطغيان هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فرو البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه ولا آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.